vomiting way before the start of chakras. I hope that it will continue throughout camp. Raise your hand. Has anybody ever here heard of Rav Shamshu Rafael Hirsch? Okay, I know Rav. Okay, now he was the leader of German Jewry at the end of the 19th century. Already when he was an older man, he once told his family that he wanted to travel and see the Alps. He had never been to the Alps before. You have to understand that Rav Shamshu Rafael Hirsch was a gadol. He was a gadol b'Torah. And they were surprised that he wanted to go and visit the Alps. Oh, what's the big deal? And he turned to his family and he said, "It won't be long before I face the Ribbono Shel Olam. And at that time, the Ribbono Shel Olam will say to me, Shamshu Rafael, what did you think of my Alps? Were they beautiful? And what am I going to tell the Ribbono Shel Olam? I never bothered to visit. I was that close. I want to see the creations of the Ribbono Shel Olam. Everything that God created in the world, likvodo bara, was created for his honor. And whether it's the Alps, or whether it's a microscopic entity that we learn what it takes to Hashem to create the world, we see the Ribbono Shel Olam. So for many years, so many years, I want to tell you a Devar Torah that I heard from in the name of Rav Moshe Scher, who was the leader of Agudas Yisrael in America. This is out of the ballpark. Listen to this Devar Torah. This is a home run. The Mishnah in Pirkei Avos says, Rabbi Yaakov Omer, Hamahalek Bederech Rishon. You're walking down the street and you're learning Torah, because you're supposed to learn Torah when you're Belech Techa Bederech. You're learning Torah, umafsik mimishnaso, and you take a break. You're a mafsik. You know what the mafsik means? You stop learning. The Omer, and you say, Ma noa ilan zeh, look at that beautiful tree. Ma noa mir zeh, look at that beautiful field. Who knows the rest of the Mishnah? You know the rest of the Mishnah? Listen to what this Mishnah says. Ma'ala ha-kosef ki'ilu mischai v'nasho. The Torah looks at it as if you're chayav misa. You deserve to be put to death. What did you do wrong? You stopped learning. You thought it's important to stop learning to see a tree? Ah, horrible. Mishnah. It always bothered me. Why everything that Hashem created was for his beauty? You're going to be punished? You're chayav misa? It's as if you're going to be punished for that? For stopping learning? Okay, you ready? You ready for this? Listen to what he said. When I heard this Devar Torah, I had a smile on my face the whole day. The Mishnah says, if you stop learning, hamafsik mi shanaso, if you stop your learning and you say how beautiful that tree is, then you're chayav. You can know what you did wrong. You thought that seeing a beautiful tree is not part of your learning. You stopped your learning to see that tree. Oh, look at that beautiful tree. You're not learning anymore? Then you're chayav, because you should look at that tree. You should look at creation and say, oh, look what the Ribbono Shel Olam created. Look how beautiful that. Look what I derived from that. It should be part of your learning. But because you stopped learning and you thought that was something separate, that's when you're chayav. Unbelievable, no? Unbelievable. You can stop your learning to see how beautiful it is. Don't stop learning. Make that part of your learning. So here we are in camp. We have a whole month in which to experience unbelievable things about Hashem's world. We're going to go to unbelievable places. It may not be the Alps. Okay, granted, we don't have that around here. You have to travel a long place. But there are beautiful rivers, and there are beautiful fields and trees and all the forests and things in nature that we're going to see. But you don't even have to go that far to experience Hashem's beauty. You can look around the world. You can see beauty. You can look into yourselves. You can look into your friends. There's so many ways to experience and to learn what Hashem's creation is about. It's part of the Torah. so we have an opportunity to learn Torah in the morning, but let's not say, now we're finished learning, and now we're doing something else. Let's make our entire day, our entire month, part of learning from Hashem, and that way, everything that we will be doing this summer will be part of the limud. Have a wonderful day, a great first day.
Our time and continue to give our full undivided attention to our Rebbeim. I just wanted to speak a little bit about deep philosophical questions, things that really have gotten the great thinkers over time to think. You know, like how much wood can a woodchuck chuck if a woodchuck could chuck wood? How high could a horse fly fly if a horse fly could fly high? Or something more deep, like does a tree that falls in a forest really make a sound if no one is there? So these are some of the questions that have really occupied the minds of our great thinkers, and I don't know if they have good answers or not, but if anyone's bored, they can think of it. I want to throw out a different question that also is worthy of great thought, a similar type of question, but I think one that we could give an answer to. And that is, in the ancient way we would say this, if someone had a buried treasure in their backyard, but they didn't know about it, are they considered a wealthy person? Or in modern terminology, you had a winning lottery ticket in your wallet, but you didn't know that it was a winning lottery ticket. So are you wealthy or are you not wealthy? Or to put it in a more base terminology, can you be happy about what you have if you don't know you have it? So this is a question I think we can give an answer by playing around with a few letters in a Hebrew word. The word for happiness, to be in happiness, is bisimcha. Right? We want to be bisimcha. If we play around the letters of bisimcha, this is something also, if anyone is bored, they can see how many words they can make out of the letters in bisimcha. But I'm thinking of one specific word, which is machshava. If you play around with the letters in Bisimcha, you can come along with Machshava, which means a thought. And God, the creator of the Hebrew language, maybe is telling us a deep message to answer this philosophical question, which is, in order to be Bisimcha, in order to truly be happy, we need to think and to contemplate about what we have and all the good that we possess. And therefore, if we have a lottery ticket or a buried treasure, but we don't know about it, we can't then truly be besimcha, because we lack the knowledge of what we have. And this can also answer another question about gratitude. We always refer to gratitude as hakarat hatov, or hakaras hatov, depending on where you're from. But the bottom line is, what does it mean hakaras hatov? The recognition of good. Why is gratitude called the recognition of good? So we can simply say like this: God forbid anyone would be such a chutzpahnik to know that he has something and somebody gave him something, but not to express gratitude. It's beneath the contemplation of the regular mind to receive good and not say thank you for it. But what if we don't perceive that we've received good? If we don't know that we've gotten good, then we can't say thank you for it, not because we're ungrateful, because we don't realize we have something. We are lacking that machshava. And therefore, we put the two things together. The key to happiness, the key to saying thank you, is the recognition of what we have and all the wealth and good that we have. We are in a time of relative lack of simcha in the 3 weeks and the 9 days. We have a mefurish pasuk in the Torah that tells us the source of our sorrow is because we were unable to serve Hashem b'simcha b'tov lei, with the good that we had. Let's hope that from today to the rest of summer, we're going to discuss ways and we're going to focus on and pay attention, building on what Rabbi Polstein said yesterday. We're going to pay attention to the world around us. We're going to pay attention to what we have. We are going to begin to think and contemplate about all that we possess, all the good that we have. We will then be able to use our machshava to be besimcha. And once we are besimcha, we will be able to express the proper hakarat hatov, thank you, and then we are going to totally transform ourselves over the next 4 weeks. Today.
Into a jail. Now, the jails back then in Baghdad were not even close to anything like we have nowadays. It's in a building. The jails back then were in a pit. He was thrown into a pit. There was nothing there, mud all around. The animals were in the pit. And for no reason. He didn't do anything wrong. He was just taken from where he was, thrown into this pit, and he had to live there for an entire year. He had to survive in this pit with what little food they threw down to him. And the only thing, there was no light the entire year. He did not see the sun the entire year. And the only thing that kept him alive, kept him going, was he knew one Masechta, one Gemara. One Gemara he knew Baal Peh. And he sat there in that pit that entire year, and he reviewed that Masechta in his mind over and over and over again. The whole year, he had nothing to do besides to review that Masechta again and again and again. He knew it by heart. By the end of the year, the Masechta that he was learning was Yevamos. By the end of the year, he had reviewed it so many times, he had gotten so fluent in the Masechta that he came out of the pit finally, they let him out, and he wrote an entire sefer on Masechta's Yevamos. And the Rav, as he got out after a year, he became very distressed. He couldn't understand. He used to daven every single night. He used to ask the Kaddish Baruch Hu, he said, just tell me why, what was it? I want to know why I had to go down into that pit, live for a year like this. I want to know why did it have to happen? I didn't do anything. And he davened and he fasted 10 days, 20 days, 30 days. And finally, he had a dream one night. And in his dream, a huge malach came to him and told him, follow me. And they walked off into a field. There was nothing around. He looked all four ways. He couldn't see anything. And he turns to the Malach and he says, I don't understand. I thought you were here to show me like why I had to go down into that pit for a year. The Malach says, okay, I'll show you, turn around. And he turns around and he sees thousands upon thousands of Malachim are all coming towards him. He gets a little scared, he doesn't understand what's going on. And as they get closer, he notices that all of these Malachim have his own face. They all look exactly like him. He gets shocked, he pulls back. He looks at the Malach by his side, he says, what's going on? I don't understand. The Malach tells him, these Malachim are standing here right now, we're neshamos. And they were stuck in that pit in Baghdad. They were stuck in that jail waiting for somebody to come and to make a bracha, to daven, to learn, to do something to uplift them, to let them be able to get into Shamayim, to let them be able to get into heaven. And for years and years and years, nobody had ever gone anywhere near that pit. Nobody had ever done anything to be able to uplift these neshamos. Until finally you were sent there, and you spent the entire year learning. And because of that, these neshamos were able to go into Shamayim, they were able to go into heaven, and they took on your appearance because you were the one who allowed them to get in. So out of respect for you, they took on your appearance. Ben Ishchai explains, we run around all day. In our normal lives, we're running, we're jumping, we're doing things. We don't always stop to think, why am I doing it? Why is it that when I'm in the middle of playing baseball, all of a sudden I get a need, an urge to have a drink, and I run over to a drinking fountain. I'm walking, and I get an urge to have something to eat. I take a seat down, and I eat something. He says, at those points, it's crucial that we remember to make our brachos. To say a bracha rishona, to say a bracha achrona, because you never know, says the Ben Ish Chai, who or what could be waiting. You never know. And you could have a tremendous opportunity at any point today, at any point in your life, to say a bracha, to bring a little more kedusha into the world. Please, don't ruin that tremendous opportunity. Have a wonderful morning, everybody.